Amen. Amen. So are we ready? Today's title is Colliding Worlds, Colliding Cultures. As we learned last week, Satan put into plan a stealth operation to seduce all humankind to a state of lawlessness. At the beginning of the last days, many people will be primed to usher in the man of lawlessness. We talked about how the world system is priming the people to be the same way that Satan is, with the same ethics, with the same thoughts, with the same beliefs. Because when they get to that point, it'll be so easy. So when the man of lawlessness appears, it's going to be so easy for them to receive him. Why? Because they're going to be with the same mindset as he is. So it's going to be easy. Right? Everything goes. Exchanging the good ethics for the situational ethics or floating ethics. Situational ethics is looking past the standard right and wrong and performing what circumstances demand. In other words, whatever circumstance you're in, that's the ethic. Whatever circumstance you're in, that's the ethic. Now, this was brought on in 1966 by a guy named Fletcher. I don't remember his first name, but his last name was Fletcher. And when he brought this on, he was a Christian, and when he brought this on, there was a lot of Christians that liked it and a lot of Christians that went against it and so forth and so forth. But you see, that's not biblical. This is not biblical, right? Is situational ethics biblical? Both of these examples fail to show that God approves of their unlawful actions. Because situational ethics is whatever you feel at that situation, at that moment, whatever you desire, whatever you want, that's what it is. Whatever situation you're in, don't worry about it. There is no consequence. There is no penalty. You could be and do whatever you want. The laws are not really enforcing what they're supposed to enforce. The laws are very weak right now. And the leaders are not in a hurry to do anything about it. So, those who attempt to employ this narrative, or this group of ethics, this narrative, in defense of situationalism, simply have missed the force of the master's argument. Because they're doing it on their own. They're taking their thoughts and implementing their thoughts and making them law. Right? Okay. So, the always are almost non-existent. And a new way of demonic moral standards, such as we have never seen before, has taken root. Remember, it took root way back. Way back where? The garden. Amen. Somebody was paying attention. Okay. Right? We may not see it in the natural, but if as if two worlds are on a collision course together, it's as if there are two different worlds. It's unseen. We cannot see it like we see matter. We cannot feel it like we feel matter, but they definitely do exist. And these two worlds are in a collision course against each other. And you're going to find out about these two worlds. Amen? And let's get going so we won't waste too much time here. They are spiritual. Right? Paul warned us about this and gave us what we would need to be able to fight spiritual war. Do you know that there is war going up in heaven right now? There is. And every time your knee hits the floor or you bow your head, it stirs it up there. And do you know that everything that happens up there takes an effect down here? We may not see it in the natural, but if as if two worlds are in a collision course, it is truth or false. It is light or darkness. And they're in a collision force. Remember that Satan told Eve and laid down his foundation, right? He told Eve, hey, go ahead and eat. You're not going to die. And what did he do when he did that? Remember I told you? When that happened and Eve saw it, took his thought upon herself, and she took of it because she believed him, and she believed the lie, she believed the false truth, and she took of it, and guess what happened? It was a fall of man. Why? Because once he saw that there is no penalty, that there is no consequence, oh, I'm not going to die. Once she saw that, she said, why not? And she took it. Wouldn't you? We do. We always take what is the easiest road for us to take. It's nothing. It's human. They are spiritual. Paul warned us about this and gave us what we would need to be able to fight these spiritual wars. Right? There is a war in heaven affecting us on earth. It's in heaven, but it's affecting us here on earth. And it's in such a stealth motion. So, do you know that the earth is turning like this? We don't feel it right. We don't feel it. We're not bouncing off going out in space. We don't feel it because it is in such so fast a speed that it keeps us grounded. These things that are happening, it is in such a stealth that we cannot see it, we cannot feel it. But guess what? It is moving and happening all around us. Even here, it's happening. Ephesians 6:11-12 says, "Wear the full armor of God. Wear God's armor so that you can fight against the devil's clever tricks." What is he saying here? He's saying that the devil is going to trick us. Are we alert? Are we alert? Oh, I better watch out because I don't want to be tricked by the enemy. And we're going to go into how he tricks us in a little bit. But the devil is going to try and trick each and every one of us because that's what he did. He tricked Eve to believing that there was no consequence. But there was consequence. Big one. Massive one. Our fight is not against people on earth. We are fighting against rulers. Oh, I've heard that so many times, Leonor. Are you going to go through that? Yes, I am. Because I want you to understand the fullness of it. We are fighting against rulers and authorities. What is authority? Authority is when someone, your boss has more authority than you do, right? It's someone that has more power or more say than you do. It says we're fighting against rulers, against authorities and powers of this world's darkness. Now listen to this. We're fighting against this world's darkness. Where is the darkness of this world? It is up there. It's up there, but it's affecting us here. We're receiving the intel here. We are fighting against rulers and authorities and powers of this world's darkness. We are fighting against the spiritual powers of evil in heavenly places. In heavenly places. Right? 2 Corinthians 10, 3 and 5. Listen to this. I'm going to read to you in the easy-to-read version. We live in this world, but we don't fight our battles in the same way the world does. Whoops. Oh. The weapons we use are not human weapons. Remember that I told you that our weapons are heavenly made? Remember that I told you that the material of our weapons are heaven material? It's awesome. It's awesome. I want to go back. I went too fast here in Ephesians 6:11. Hold on where I am right now, and let's go back to that. Wear the full armor of God. How do we wear the full armor of God? I want to see something if you remember. I want to... Oh, here it is. Okay. How do you wear the full armor of God? Truth. When you're walking in the truth, and I'm talking about every day, every hour, every minute, are you speaking the truth? Are you saying a white lie? Because there is no such thing as a white lie. Are you speaking the truth? Are you making a little half truth, half lie? If you're doing that, that is Satan's character. Who do you have in you? Who do you have in you if you are stretching the truth or you are embellishing the truth? Whose are you? Because if you're filled with the Word, if you're filled with the Spirit, that should not be coming out of you. What should be coming out of you is truth. That should be coming out of you. So what do we do? When we say something, just make sure that it's the truth. If my goodness gracious, if someone offended you and they came to you and said, "Will you forgive me? I was told that I offended you. Will you forgive?" "Oh no, no, you didn't offend me. Oh no, no, you didn't offend me." And they did. That's an outright lie. You're not being truthful. And guess what? Because you're lying, is the situation going to be settled? No. Because Father God is hearing you say a lie. And how does He think about lies? Do you understand what I'm saying? So, be truthful. You're a Christian. You carry His name. You are an ambassador of His. When they see you, they should see the character of Christ. At home, at the store, especially your family. especially your family. It's easy to be one way here at the church. Oh, yes, holier than thou. Oh, yes, hallelujah. And then at home, you're cussing up a storm. It's not funny. It's serious business. Because the neighbors are seeing everything. And they see you get up every morning on Sunday, you put the Bible under your arm, you get down, you go to church, you come back, and you have a foul mouth. We are in the last days. What are we showing the world? What are we showing them? Are we showing them Christ? Now, I know that the people in here do. They show Christ. I know they do. I don't care if you laugh. I know you do. You do. But some of you out there don't. One or two or three in here, maybe not. But most of us, we do. So, walking in truth. When you walk in truth, guess what? You're wearing a part of an armor, of the armor. Sorry, ladies. Live righteous. How do we live righteous? How do you live when the doors are closed behind you? Not when you're with people. I'm getting to the nitty-gritty here. Not when you're with people. How do you live in your home? What are you putting before your eyes? Remember, we made a covenant with our eyes. What do we put before our eyes? What do we hear? Are we living a righteous life every day? It's supposed to be normal to us. It's supposed to be normal for us to live a righteous life. What is a righteous life? Doing the best that you can. None of us are perfect. And if anyone thinks they're perfect, I'm going to bring a cup with water and I want you to stand on it. None of us are perfect. All of us messed up badly. But we say, Father God, and we mean it with our hearts. I'm sorry. I had to apologize this past week. I was very sorry. I did something unknowingly. And you're going to hear about it, but I'll tell you later. But right now I'm talking about righteous life. So we're living a righteous life. Guess what that is? That's another part of the armor. So, we're doing that. Now, prepared with the gospel. Prepared with the gospel. Are we preparing ourselves with the gospel every day? Do you read your devotions? Do you read your devotions? Do you meditate in the Father? Do you meditate that day and say, Father God, this is a beautiful present you've given me, Father. I'm going to open it, and I want you to open it with me. And whatever comes out of this day, Lord, so long as you are with me, we can unwrap the present together. Right? And we're ready for whatever comes. Are we prepared enough with the gospel that we're ready to receive a phone call? Oh, sister, I'm going through this. Can you pray for me? Will you be ready to pray at that moment? Or do you have to think, wait, let me look at the book. Wait a minute. No. You have to be ready in season and out of season. Be ready at a moment's call. sister shared with me earlier this week, and it really, really blessed my heart. And I said, I want to be like her. She wasn't feeling well at all. And she got a call. And the person that she got a call from needed help. So she went and helped her. That is, number one, living in righteousness, and that is being prepared with the gospel. Because I know this sister, and I know that whatever she says the word of God. And that really ministered to me. I didn't say anything, but it did minister to me. Are we prepared? What is the gospel? Good news. What is it? Is it okay? It's good, Leonor, but what is news? What news are you talking about? News that this life that we're living, we don't have to live. We have a life better, a life with more abundance. We have a life that in our view is eternal life. We will never die. We will live eternally with our Maker. This that we're going through is passive. It's going to pass. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It's going to pass. It's going to pass. This that we're living right now, this life that we're living right now, is going to pass for a better one. That's awesome. An eternal one. Why? Because of Jesus. Because we live in Him and He lives in us. And prepare yourself with the gospel. Get ready, learn, study, so that you will not be caught unaware. So that you will be prepared. Study the word of God. Amen? Then, where do I write it? Okay. Faith. Oh, that's a hard one, huh? Not really. Not really if you understand it. Because we're saying, oh, I have faith. I have faith. Oh, yeah, I have faith. Really? Are we really walking in faith? I've heard it said that when we pick up the shield of faith, it will protect us in the front. But we're open in the back. And we're open in the back because we don't want to win. I'm going to change that and I'm going to tell you the truth. When you look up the word, take up the shield of faith. That word, take up, it doesn't necessarily mean that, okay, you're going to take up the word and no, it means position. It's more of a positioning of your faith. Where are you positioning your faith? Because the shield that, I don't know about you, but my shield is a spiritual shield. It is a heavenly shield. It is from heaven. And my shield does not only protect my front, it protects my front, it protects my back, it protects my sides, it protects me all over. You understand what I'm saying? My shield is like, you ever seen those clocks that used to be picked up and you had a glass covering? You know how you put it over? Well, that glass protected that clock all the way around, right? Yeah, even up there, because it's all covered. Yeah, yes. And time represents life, because that's what life is, time. So my shield covers me all the way around. All the way around. The devil cannot attack me from the back. He cannot attack me from the side. He cannot attack me from anywhere because my shield is positioned well. When you have faith, what is it? Whatever you're going through, no matter what it is, if you trust Him, your shield is on you. No matter what you're going through, but I'm going through a bad stuff, and this thing has happened bad, it's bad. Trust Him. He'll get you through the fire. Trust Him. Because He didn't say that everything was going to be hunky-dory. He just said that you're not going to go through it by yourself. He's going to go through it with you. So no matter how bad things are, don't think that because they're bad, oh, Lord, you abandoned me. Oh, Lord, you can't hear me. Oh, Lord, no. He's right there. It is us that don't trust Him. It is, you know when you pray and we're praying in the Spirit and we're praying and, oh, I love it when we pray, when the girls get together and we pray for an hour and, oh, man, we get up and we feel like we could, oh. So, you know, we feel like, and we say, we really got near. It isn't that He got near to us. Because He's been with us all along. It's that we got near to Him. It isn't that He came. No, He's here. He's with us. It's that we got near to Him. Amen? So faith, persist in your faith. Faith is not, well, I have faith in this. Oh, well, I doubt this. But no. Persist in your faith all the way around. And you're going to see mighty miracles. And you're going to see yourself change, your life change. And you're going to say, wait a minute, a week ago, a month ago, I should have reacted this way and I didn't. What happened? You changed because your heart changed. And your heart changed because you're wearing your armor. There's no way the enemy can attack you when you persist in your faith. There's no way the enemy can accuse you when you walk in the truth. Right? There's no way that a lot of stuff can happen around you when you're living a righteous life. The enemy can't hear me walk around you. He may be waiting for you to give a little opening, a little, so he can come in. But if you're wearing the armor, he won't be able to. The armor is your defense. It's your armor to protect you. It's not your weapon. It's to protect you. We do have a weapon, though. So we live in truth. We live in righteousness. We're prepared with the gospel. And we position our faith. You right? Now, what's next? What's next in the armor? Helmet. Thank you. The helmet of salvation. Oh, what is that? Oh, the helmet of salvation. You know what? Let me tell you about the helmet of salvation. Where does the helmet go? Where is your heart? Remember that we studied the heart? Who can give me the definition of the word heart? When Jesus said, give me your heart, what's the definition of that word heart in that verse? Huh? The feelings and thoughts of your mind. That is the meaning of that. Look it up in the Strong. That is the meaning of the word heart. The feelings and the thoughts of your mind. When you put your helmet on, you're putting it on your mind. Guard your mind. Right? Protect your thoughts. Don't allow someone else's thoughts to become your thoughts. So, the helmet of salvation. Okay, not only, don't think that, okay, well, I'm saved. When I die, I'm saved for all eternity. That's not the only thing that you're saved from. You are saved from everything that the enemy can come against you. You're safe. You've been saved. There's nothing that the enemy can come against you. No weapon formed against you shall what? Prosper. Do you believe that? If you believe that, you're way on your way, way well on your way. Because salvation, he'll save us. How did he save me from cancer? I still have cancer. How did he save me from that? If you trust him, you may have cancer in your body, but you don't have cancer in your spirit. It is the spirit, it is the soul that they're fighting for. So what if the body goes? The spirit keeps on. You know what I'm saying? So put on the helmet of salvation. In other words, you are guarded. If you have the helmet of salvation, what can the enemy can't attack you in your thought, what can he do to you? Nothing. Nothing. Don't give him your thoughts. Don't give him your thoughts. He is going to try and put his thoughts in you. But if you listen to it, you are going to entertain it, and you're going to change, because that's what Eve did. It is in us. We're born with it. That's the time Jesus had to come and make us right again. He took that sin that had happened in the garden. He came and he set us right again with our Father. But we have a choice. We will always have a choice. Amen? Always have a choice. Now, if you are daily, if you speak the truth, if you're living a righteous life, if you're prepared with the gospel, if you have your faith positioned all the way around, if you have the helmet of salvation on, if you're guarding your mind, being alert, always guarding your mind, guess what you're doing? You're yielding that sword. You have that sword, which is the word of God, positioned to do damage to the enemy. You are ready for war. And there's nothing, oh, I get goofy. There's nothing that the enemy can do against you if you have that sword, which is the word of God. So, the enemy can't attack. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of evil. Remember, that's the devil. Don't be afraid of it. Why? Why are you, if you check out, if you put a check on what you're doing, you will say, hey, I'm wearing the armor. And you didn't even know you were wearing the armor. You didn't know you were wearing the armor because you were thinking of a belt. You were thinking of shoes. You were thinking of a breastplate. You think that's good and everything, but those are metaphors. They're metaphors for the truth, for this. They're just metaphors to train children. But for us adults, we need to know what the armor is and walk on it. As a matter of fact, even children do today. Maybe not before, but today they need to know this. So, there's nothing that the enemy can do against us. Nothing. Now we could go back. I just wanted you to understand the armor. Did we understand a little bit better? Did we remember it? Okay. Now, 2 Corinthians 10, 3, 5. And we left off in verse 5. Well, let me start over again from the beginning. Verse 3. We live in this world, but we don't fight our battles in the same way the world does. No, because our weapons are spiritual weapons. The weapons we use are not human ones. Our weapons have power from God and can destroy the enemy's strong places. Our weapons have power from God. Did you hear that? That's on verse 4, 2 Corinthians 10. We're reading from 3 to 5. Verse 4 says, the weapons we, his people, his children, use are not human ones. Our weapons have power from God and can destroy the enemy's strong places. Why? Because the power comes from God, not from us. Because we trust him to do our battle. We destroy people's what? Arguments. I'm going to tell you something. When you speak the truth, and someone wants to argue with you, blah, 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 just be calm and say, no, no. Speak the truth. Speak peace. Speak quietly. And hear the word. Not too long ago, someone was getting a little warm in the cut of the collar and was saying certain things. And I said, no, I don't think so. Oh, I don't, no, I don't think so. Well, why? And then I said, because this and this and this and this. And they just backed off and looked at me like, oh. Why? Because when I shared, I was calm, and I shared the word of God in a calm way, without, you know, because I could. When I do it that way, and when you do it that way, you save an argument. You don't argue. You don't argue with other people about the word. That's not what the word is made for. The word is for us to learn and grow, but not to use as debate. Not, huh? I'm sorry. No, you don't use it as a whip. It's not. Don't get boldness confused with arrogance. That's what Paul was talking about. Paul was saying, you know, many of you are accusing me of being bold, of being, you know, but a lot of times it's the zeal of the person, and you are confusing it with boldness, and a lot of times you don't want to hear the truth, and you just don't want to hear it. So, it's this, verse 5, and we tear down every proud idea that raises itself against the knowledge of God. What did Satan do? What did Satan tell Eve? You know, you will receive knowledge like God. You will know good and evil. We also capture, listen to this, we also capture every thought. Here's the word again, thought. And make it give up and obey Christ. In other words, instead of arguing, what you do is you come down, then the person comes down, and it opens the door, and before you know it, you're sharing Christ, and before you know it, you've got somebody that got saved and came into the kingdom. Isn't that awesome? Second Corinthians 10:4 in the Message, it says the same thing. The tools of our trade aren't for marketing or manipulation. A lot of times, a lot of people use the word of God and manipulate it. They use it for marketing. Be very careful. Be very careful that you don't spend $1,000 to get a little base of oil. Oh, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? But they are for demolishing the entire massively corrupt culture. Listen, culture. The tools are made to demolish the corrupt culture. Our culture is being corrupt daily, more and more and more. Our tools, our weapons are to demolish them massively. We use our powerful God's tools for smashing warped philosophies. What are philosophies? Philosophies are the rational investigation of truth and principles of being, knowledge, and contact. That's what philosophies are. They are a rational investigation of the truth. And our tools are to smash these warped principles, these warped beings, these warped knowledge that they're sending out, you know, the situational ethics, warped knowledge, and warped conduct. Conduct is for tearing down barriers erected against the truth of God. Everything that the system is doing, that the world is doing, is going against the truth of God. It's going against it. I haven't seen or heard anyone in great politics or great that are saying, hooray for the Christians. Hooray. Not very many. Not very many. That, to take down barriers erected against the truth of God, fitting every loose thought and emotion and impulse into the structure of the life shaped by Christ. We don't understand the power we carry inside of us. Colliding worlds, colliding cultures. Slide 37. The point of impact will be very soon. It's going to be a big thing when those two collide. A big thing. Slide. Remember it began in the garden back in Genesis. Satan wanted to be as God. And put his plan, but his plan backfired. So he developed a stealth operation. Keep in mind that back then, and that Satan does not see time in the realm that we see it. Time to us is 24 hours a day. Satan doesn't see it that way. So Satan planted that stealth operation with ease, he wasn't thinking of, oh, let's see how much. He wasn't thinking of, no. Because that type of time, we have it here on earth. We are subject to time. The heavenly things are not. The celestial things are not. They're not. So he developed a stealth operation. Keep in mind that his timing is different than our timing. His plan was so diabolical and so cunning, he put in a stealth motion. He put it in stealth motion. It would hardly be detected by mankind. Oh, let me share. Remember I told you I was going to share something about you that I had to ask for forgiveness for? Last week, I went home after class. I went home and, you know, went to bed and everything, 3:30 and 4 o'clock in the morning, I kind of turn around. You know how you turn around in bed to get yourself more comfortable? Well, I kind of turn around and to get myself more comfortable, and I open my eyes, and I can't explain it. I can't pinpoint it. All I can say is that it was like I understood Father saying, don't fall into the trap that is there. Don't be tricked by Satan. And I couldn't understand it. I couldn't understand what he was trying to tell me. And I said, what did I do? And all this happened just in an instant. And I said, what did I do? And he said, what did Satan do to Eve in the garden? When Satan told Eve that she will not die, what happened to Eve? When Satan told Eve, oh, you shall not surely die, before Eve respected the word of God, she feared the word of God. I'm going to tell you something. Fear is good. Fear is good. And I've heard it said, oh, no, the fear is talking about is respect. Yes, it is. But it's also fear, kingdom. When mama says, if you do this, I'm going to spank you, that fear will keep you from doing what you did. That kind of fear is what I'm talking about. If a diesel is coming, and it's coming fast, and I need to cross the street, and the diesel is coming real fast, it's my decision, right? Either I'm going to run and make it, or the diesel is going to hit me. I'm going to respect the diesel. I'm not going to run. No way, Jose. I don't want to be an ink spot on the road. But what did Satan do? When Satan told Eve, you shall not surely die, when Eve understood that, and she said, oh, there went the fear. And she had no more fear. Because she wasn't going to die. There went the consequence. There's no more consequence. So she wasn't afraid. But she went ahead and took it. And I said, Father, when did I do that? And he said, when I am giving you the word, when I am giving you the word and warning you about the last days, and I'm warning you, don't take it lightly. Don't joke about it. And I said, when did I do that? Because, remember, the enemy is so stealth. I mean, he's really moving slowly. But you can detect it. I didn't know what I had done. I couldn't see it. I couldn't detect it. I couldn't. I was like, when did I do that? Well, I'm going to share this with you guys' permission, if I can, to share this. Because they told me to share it with a lady. Last Thursday, after class, we were picking up and everything, and I was in the office, and Rose went over there and said, do you know what Cindy told me? And I said, why? Because she told me, what did you say? Oh, yeah. She told me something about situational thought. She gave me a situational thought, trying to be good this week. And I laughed. And so I came in and I told Cindy, I like that. I like that thought that you gave Rose, try to be good. And I laughed. And we laughed. But you know what? I didn't realize that when I laughed, it took the seriousness of the matter away. I made a joke of it. It was laughter. So it no longer had the same effect. because I took the seriousness of it away. It was a longer series. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, the thought, these little floating thoughts. Uh-oh. We need to be very careful and very watchful. He comes in like that. We cannot see him. We cannot feel him. We cannot. He comes in so quietly. We don't even see it. We have to be quiet more, listen more, and be more alert with our eyes. Because we cannot see him at work when we, when, from now on, when he warns me, I am not going to take it lightly. Because he put it down through Paul and told them, this is what's going to happen at the end of the days. And this is what you're going to see. You as had. You're the ones that are going to be in this era, in this dispensation. You're the ones that are going to see these things happen. But this is what I'm warning you. Don't do this. Watch out for this. Do that. All this is serious. He is serious. He is serious because he loves us. And he is telling us these things to warn us. He is telling us these things so that we can be prepared and the enemy will not come and trick us and we fall like he did. That's why. It isn't that, oh my God, here's a, no, no, no. My goodness, sister, he loves us. What an immense love does the Father have that he took the time to write everything down for us today. Isn't that awesome? Paul wrote these letters. He was writing to the Corinthians, and he was writing to the Thessalonians. He wrote this letter for us. He wasn't with the Thessalonians. He said, don't panic, don't worry. Because they were hearing, back then, they were hearing that the day of the Lord had already arrived. He said, no, it hasn't already arrived. Why? Because he knew that that wasn't the generation. We are the generation. So now, he told us, when he was telling Timothy, when he wrote him the second letter, he was telling Timothy, this is what you're going to see. This is what's going to happen in our time today, in this era, in this dispensation. Wow. Isn't that awesome? My goodness, where was I? Where was I? Okay. Yes, the philosophy. Tearing down the barriers erected against the truth of God. Fitting every used thought and emotion and impulse into the structure of shaped by Christ. Colliding worlds, colliding cultures. The point of impact. His plan. Okay, here I was. Here I am. He used God's word and this is what happened. His plan was so diabolical and so cunning, he put in a stealth motion. It would hardly be detected by humankind. Be careful you don't fall into the same trick Satan used on Eve. He used, listen how he did it. He used God's word and added his own. And when he did that, these words canceled out the meaning of God's word and put it in exact opposite meaning. He canceled God's words out, and he put it in the exact opposite meaning. You shall not surely die, but you will become like God. God's warning, it lost its impact, and because it no longer carried the consequence, it was taken lightly. And we don't want to do that, right? We don't want to do that. Slowly with time, he began to work with the help of those who rejected the truth of God. infiltrating the thoughts of man and spawning his thoughts. Ooh, I hate that word. Spawning his thoughts. The very thoughts, right? He floated in heaven with the angels and was able to turn the hearts of those angels to his way of thinking. Mutiny. Mutiny. What is mutiny? Mutiny is revolt or rebellion against constituted authority. That's what he did up there. He talked to the angels. He convinced them. He put his thoughts in their thoughts. He convinced them, and they fell with him. Mutiny. And they accompanied Satan when he fell. And now, in return, he made God's children fall. But Father had a plan much better than Satan's, right? He made for us a way of escape. His name is Jesus. Name above all names. Amen? Amen. Amen. Philippians 2, 9 and 11. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him because of the cross, highly exalted him, given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. There will be and is already on the scene of a mutinous, rebellious attitude against God, such as we have ever seen. And it will be much worse soon. The rebellion will be rebellion as a man of lawlessness appears. Like in 2 Thessalonians 2, 3 in the King James Version, Paul warns us, let no man deceive you by any means. In other words, by any means. Just until last week, just because it sounds holy, just because it looks holy, just remember, Satan was Lucifer. Satan was the most beautiful angel. He knows how to work people. They are masterful manipulators. They know how to work people. They'll go with you, especially if they know you have a little something going on in your life. They will attach to you in that manner, and you cannot detect that spirit unless you are in the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will guide you and reveal it to you. By any means, he said, don't be deceived by any means. That's why we trust God 100%. For that day shall not come, the day after the Lord shall not come, except there come a falling away first. And that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. We're going to do something real quick. Right? In 2 Thessalonians, this is I'm going to read to you in a simpler version so we could get it better in our minds. Don't be carried away and deceived regardless of what they say. For that day will not come until two things happen. First, there will be a time of great rebellion against God. Are we seeing that? And then the man of rebellion will come. The son of hell. Right? Look at how they address him. The son of hell. In the Message Bible, they call him Antichrist. Real dog of Satan. In the New King James Version, they call him the son of perdition. In the Easy to Read Version, they call him the man of evil. The one who belongs in hell. In the New American Standard Bible, the son of destruction. In verse 7, he is called the law. Thessalonians 2:5-6 in the Living Bible. Paul was saying, don't you remember that I told you this when I was with you? See, we have a hard time remembering things. And you know what is keeping him from, look at what is keeping him from being here today. I mean, from being in the scene. You know what is keeping him from being here already. For he can come only when his time is ready. Does that sound familiar? It should. And let me remind you of something. In 2 Thessalonians 2:5, in the easy to read version, I told you the same scripture. I told you before that all these things would happen. Remember, and you know what is stopping that man of evil now. He is being stopped now so that he will appear at the right time. Everything is in its time, in its dispensation, in its era. Amen? Remember Jesus when he came? Like Matthew 8:29, New King James Version. And suddenly they cried out, saying, what have we to do? Oh, this is when the guy with these demons came up, and the demons cried out. And suddenly they cried out, saying, what do we have to do with you, Jesus, you Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before the time? In John 2:4, Jesus answered, this is another one. Jesus answered, dear woman, remember when his mother wanted wine? And he said, dear woman, why are you telling me this? She wanted him to make wine. Why are you telling me this? It is not yet time for me to begin my work. Everything has its time. John 7:3-7, easy to read version. So his brother said to him, his brothers were very jealous of him anyway. His brother said to him, Jesus' brother, you should leave here and go to the festival in Judea. Then your followers there can see the miracles you do. If you want to be well known, you must not hide what you do. See, what are they trying to do here? They're trying to get him to show off. They're trying to get him so the people, Jesus never called attention to himself. Never. Ever. So, if you can do such amazing things, and let the whole world see you do them. Jesus' brother said this because even they did not believe in him. Jesus said to them, the right time for me has not yet come. But any time is right for you to go. The world cannot hate you, but the world hates me. Look at why the world hates him. The world hates me because I tell the people in the world that they do evil things. When you disciple someone, you have to be honest in a loving way, but you have to be honest. If a person is not ready to hear the truth, they will get upset with you. If they're not ready, they'll say, oh, forget you, because they don't want to do what is required of them to do so that they can grow and move on in their walk with Christ. They're very satisfied where they are. They just don't want to listen. They don't want to pull away from that because it's no use. Just pull away from it. Let someone else, let Father God prepare someone else and come. Because we're not all meant to say, you know, that's why we are created different. You draw people of your own kind, you know, by your own kindness, your own spiritual, you know what I'm saying? If a person is very quiet and timid, you're not going to you're not going to pair him up with someone that's blah, 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 like me. You know, it'll hurt her because the personalities don't match, right? Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, John 7:29-30. I know him because I am. When he was saying that he was the Son of God, he was trying to tell the people. I know him because I am from him. He is the one who sent me. Jesus was saying. When Jesus said this, the people tried to grab him, but no one was able to even touch him because the right time for him had not yet come. Time. Just like Jesus then, remember, Satan copies everything that Jesus does. Just like Jesus then, Satan now awaits. Second Thessalonians 2:3, and then you can change version. Back in the day, Paul told the Thessalonians, let no man deceive you. This is, remember when I talked to you about the falling away? He said, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except that come of falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. This verse is telling us that Christians, that we'll see this great falling away, our generation. But you have to understand what the word falling away means. We think it means one thing, but look at what it means. A great falling away. And see the man of lawlessness appear. We will be those of the dispensation or era of the last days. They are the ones who will witness the world changing, abandonment of morals, ethics, and truth, worldwide mutiny arising against God and His Word. We are living in those days, which is why we see abandoning of godliness in society today. It is so important that we understand the season, the temperature, the climate of this dispensation. The era we have chosen to live, we must dig deeply, just delve into and discern the time. The word falling away, slide, in this verse is the Greek word apostasia, which describes a falling away or a widespread revolt of political revolt against authority. Political revolt against authority. The Old Testament documents also use the same word to describe a turning away from the Lord. These words are like their military language. This is military language. The commentator said, Paul, a scholar who understood the meaning of this word for Thessalonica, used it to forecast a rebellion, mutiny, or insurgency against God that would occur on a worldwide basis against God in the very end of the last days, as the age comes to the final conclusion. Do you see that now? Isn't it happening now? Paul continues to say the same words in this same verse, that the day won't come until a falling away and the man of sin be revealed. Until the Antichrist is revealed, Paul called him man of sin. The word sin, in this case, is the Greek word anomia. Anomia. Which the form of this word is nomos, which means law in Greek. Did you get that? Okay. The word sin in the Greek is anomia. A form of the word anomia is nomos, which means law. Law, authority. Law. Sin means law. It is used to describe the standards of what is legally and morally correct. Isn't that something? But when you add an A in front of the word, it becomes anomia. Adding an A cancels the meaning and changes it to the exact opposite meaning. Nomos means law. It changes to anomia, sin. Meaning without law or lawlessness. Isn't that something? It no longer depicts the standard of what is legally and morally correct. Now it means no fixed morals and no law. Lawlessness. That's what it is. Paul used these words to prophetically describe in the last days leaders and societies who will do away with previously agreed upon morals or standards, away from the well-established laws Father God had given his people to follow. If there are no fixed morals, if there are no standards, there is no law, no moral correction. If there is no law, there are no laws to break. Doesn't that sound like the Garden of Eden? If there are no laws to break, there is no fear of consequences. You think people got fearful of getting arrested? You know what they say? Oh, we're going to get out tomorrow. I'm going to get arrested today. I'm going to go in. I'm going to steal all this from the store. They're going to arrest me. Who cares? I'll be out tomorrow in the morning. No ethics. Then we will just have situational ethics, floating ethics. The world of God has rules and laws for our benefit so that we may live on this earth in abundance, in peace, and in joy. The author says the Bible tells us that the part of the last day scheme, society will construct a new world order that has few, if any, hard and fast rules of what is morally right or wrong. It's hardly not going to mean nothing. There hardly is nothing right now. In essence, this will be a lawless world that is a world free from the outdated voice of the Bible. Society will attempt to disconnect from most moral standards that were once held in the common rule and view of society. That is what lawlessness means. That is the atmosphere in which these end-time boasters will increase. Are we in that atmosphere now? I feel we are, and it's going to get worse. Paul uses this word sin, anomia, in connection with the Antichrist. Next week, we will try to learn more about him. Light and darkness, truth and false, colliding worlds, colliding culture. Amen? Did we learn? Any questions? Did anybody get anything special that you didn't know before? Yes. 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 Right. That's why we have to walk in the armor. That's why we have to walk in the armor. If we're walking in this armor, we won't be deceived. Because we trust in him. He won't allow it to happen. The reason it was happened with Eve is because Eve allowed it. You know, it didn't make any difference. But you're right. We do have to pray for discernment. Definitely. Always pray for discernment. Pray for discernment every day. So, any questions? Anybody got anything interesting out of it? Huh? There's plenty. Yes, there is plenty. You can't disciple one. There's plenty. So, okay, well, Heavenly Father, we give you the glory and the honor. And we thank you, O Lord. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you for loving us like you do. We thank you for revealing the things that you have revealed to us and to continue revealing. We're just digging in the Word. We're just digging in your Word. We're just digging the definitions in your language, in your time. We want to know what it meant. We want to know what it means so that we can apply it. Everything has changed. Meanings have changed. Everything has changed. But you remain unchangeable. Your truth is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Your doctrine remains the same. There is an unchanging doctrine. Serve you with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and help and love one another. Father, we give you all the glory and the honor, and we thank you. Lord, we do pray for discernment for people, Lord, that do not know, Father. Draw them in, Father. Draw those people that have their names written in the book of life from the foundation of the earth. Even before they were weaved in their mother's womb, their name was already there. So, Father God, draw them in these last days. Give us opportunities to witness, Lord. Give us opportunities to share, Father. We give you all the glory and the honor. Thank you, Lord. We depart from here, but not from each other, and definitely not from you. We give you all the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray and we say, Amen.